Processing of urine, we firstly look at the microscopy. How does the urine look? Is it clear or cloudy? Is it tepid, bloody, or synthochromic? Then we go to microscopy. That's where we do a wet prep using iodine, and some prefer not to use iodine, just a drop of urine on a slide, and they look under a microscope. They look for the presence or the absence of bacteria. They look for white blood cells, red blood cells, casts, parasites, and yeasts. And we have to report on everything that you see. Is it present or absent? Then we go to culture, where we use chromogenic media such as Uriselect, or we use selective and non-selective agar, like blood agar. With urine culture, we have to report quantitatively. So we should use, or we always have to use, 1 microliter sterile loop, and we streak on our chromogenic media. Then we culture for 24 hours at 37 degrees in presence of oxygen. That's aerobic conditions. Then we report as colonies per mil of urine. Then after culture, we do confirmatory tests, including Gram stain, then sensitivity. The processing of stool is almost similar to urine. We start with microscopy, where we have to report on the consistency of the stool. Is it formed, unformed, mucoid, bloody? Then we go into culture, where we use a set of different plates, including a McConkie plate with crystal violet, because this selects for gram-negative bacteria. We also have a set of plates which is Salmonella Shigella agar, or the XLD, which we use to identify the Salmonella in the Shigella species. Then we use a Tetros blood agar with a filter paper. This is cultured microaerophilically, and it's to identify Campylobacter species. We also have a broth, a selenite broth, or a tetrathionate broth. This broth is reducing agents to exclude carbon dioxide, so we culture this aerobically. After 24 hours at 37 degrees Celsius in presence of oxygen, we then subculture on Salmonella Shigella agar or the XLD agar. Then we have another plate, which is the TCBS plate. This selects for Vibrio species. Then, if there are fungal cultures requested, we can add a plate, which is the dextrose agar, the Sabarauz dextrose agar, the SDA. Then, after culturing for 24 hours, we can then do confirmatory tests and then sensitivity. The processing of sputum, we start with microscopy. How does it look? Is it purulent? Is it mucoid? Is it bloody? Then we do microscopy. That's where we do a Gram stain or a ZN, the Zeunersen stain, if TB is suspected. Then we do culture. The culture of sputum, we mainly use a blood agar and a McConkie plate. Then we have a chocolate agar, which we use to culture fastidious organisms such as Haemophilus influenza. And we use a Colombian blood agar with gentamicin. This is to identify Streptococcus species. The chocolate agar and the Colombian blood with gentamicin, they are cultured anaerobically for 24 hours. And after, we do confirmatory tests that include Gram stain and the Lancefield grouping. The CSF, it is characterized as an aged specimen. What does that mean? That means CSF, we have to culture it as soon as possible. Why? Because we want to look for fastidious organisms such as S. influenza and Neisseria meningitis. So, usually CSF is a sterile sample. We expect to see nothing, no organisms. But if someone has meningitis, if the patient is an adult, we suspect organisms like Haemophilus influenza, Streptococcus pneumonia, Streptococcus agalactiae, and Neisseria meningitis. But it's slightly different with neonates, because neonates, they get neonatal meningitis, which is mainly caused by Escherichia coli, E. coli, Strep agalactiae, and the Listeria species. So we start with macroscopy when we are doing the CSF processing. The macroscopy involves the volume of the CSF, the color of the CSF, which is normally clear and colorless. If the CSF is turbid, that can suggest an increase in white cell count. If it is xanthochromic, that means an old bleed, like a bleed that is a week old or something, because the red blood cells, when they break down in the CSF, they will be red, but as the hemoglobin breaks down, it then turns to a yellowish color. If the CSF is bloody, that suggests a clot in the CSF, or there was a problem with the process of taking the CSF, the lumbar puncture. When we do the microscopy, we mainly focus on the cell count, where we take 1 microliter of crystal violet with 100 microliters of the CSF. Then we mix, then we put in a counting chamber, we let it settle, then we view under a microscope under a 40 times lens. Then we report on the white cell count, the red blood cell count. Then we have to do a Gram stain for microorganisms. And if they suspect yeast, we can do an Indian ink to look for Cryptococcus neoformans. The culture, we do culture on blood and chocolate agar 24 hours at 37 degrees Celsius anaerobically. So normally, we are not supposed to see any red blood cells or neutrophils or lymphocytes in the CSF. Usually there is 0 to 5 lymphocytes. But if there is increased number of lymphocytes, that suggests a viral or TB meningitis. And if there is increase in the neutrophils or the polymorph neutrophils, that suggests bacterial meningitis. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll catch you in my next video.